Hello world, it's Mike Campbell here again, the host of the Legal Outliers. And today, we have a member of the Legal Outliers. His name is Manuel Veiga Jr. And he is a member of the Cabo Verdean community. And Manny's a very well-spoken person. My first semester, he helped me out with some of the classwork when I didn't know what I was doing. And I think he's a great guy to know, so I want you guys to stay tuned and listen to his story.
My name is Manny Veiga. I go by Manny or Junior, and I'm a member of the Legal Outliers.
So tell us a little bit about yourself.
A little bit about me. Currently I'm 29 years old, reside in Randolph. Currently engaged to be married. I have a fiance. Currently work at a law firm, also on my own commercial cleaning service. And also doing the law school thing with Mike with the Legal Outliers, trying to take that to the next level as well. So I've got a lot going on, but I love it. You know what I mean?
Tell us a little bit. Tell me a little bit about the environment you was raised in.
I was raised in the environment I was raised in. That's a great question. I'm actually very fortunate till this day because both of my parents were actually still together. And again, till this day, even more so when I was younger, they were just always there supporting me and just always was around letting me know I could do whatever I wanted to do and whatnot, regardless of the environment that you were raised in around you. I always lived in Randolph, but my mother worked for a salon in Dorchester, so I went to the Boys and Girls Club out there for a little bit and whatnot, so I saw a different way of life than how I was living in the suburbs. So it was definitely a blessing to be raised the way I was raised by my parents, I would say, and just to have their support the whole way is, I can't even explain what it means, you know?
Were your parents born in this country?
They were not. No, they were actually born in Cape Verde. So they were immigrants, and they immigrated here, I believe, when they were about 25 years old, roughly around that age, possibly a little bit younger. And again, obviously, they came over here just for a better life for themselves and their children.
Okay. So now, did you go to high school in Randolph?
For high school, yes, I did go to high school in Randolph. I actually went to Randolph High School. Sophomore through senior year before graduating and moving on to LaSalle University.
Okay, so what were some of the things you was interested in when you were in high school?
In high school, what interests kids in high school? Oh, obviously sports. Yeah, Ron, we do the sports thing. Soccer in the fall, basketball in the winter, baseball in the spring. It's really just sports and friends in high school, right? You're there doing your thing with your friends, playing sports, and just trying to have fun, obviously, while doing the academic thing at the same time. So it was cool.
So if you could think back, tell us one of your favorite songs when you was in high school.
Oh, I actually have the favorite song when I was in high school was I'm a Hustler by Cassidy. Because, again, Cassidy, that first of all, he was one of my favorite rappers growing up, the all time. And that song, I really felt that song and the meaning behind it, how he just essentially would just work to get what he wants. When he puts his mind on something, he finishes it and accomplishes his goal. You know what I mean? So I can certainly relate to that song.
Okay. So at what point did you realize that you wanted to go to law school?
At what point did I realize I wanted to go to law school? That's a great question. Great question. I would say that the clear point that I realized it, I'm not even sure if this is the best time to say it, but it was actually when I felt that I was in a situation with the police, and I was just treated differently than others in that same situation were, and things were handled a little bit differently. So I ever kind of since that point and just in general reading things on the news and reading articles about what happens in America today, whatever I can do to kind of make a difference and make an impact, especially on the inner city that may not have the same access to attorneys or aid or anything in general as folks that live out here in the suburbs, if I can really just hopefully help those folks out there know that there's somebody there for them, there's somebody there to help them through whatever they got to go through, I'm just trying to help in any way that I can, really.
Okay. What made you want to become a member of the Legal Outliers?
Honestly, you're driving your passion for it. The first time you came up and you spoke to me about it, I could see the fire in your eyes. And ever since that first conversation, as we were discussing even before everything started, you haven't stopped. So folks that are motivated like that and really have that fire in their stomach and want to get going, I can easily get with a program like that. And obviously everything you stand for, how essentially you want to actually target the same crowd that I was referring to, which is the inner city, and just let them know that regardless of the environment you're raised in, there's always a different option, especially if you put your mind to it, you can accomplish whatever you want to.
Okay, so now as a member of the Legal Outliers, what do you feel you can offer people that are raised in those environments? Like, how do you feel you could reach those individuals?
I think, again, your plan of going to the high schools, middle schools of those communities is a great start. I currently have family members that live in those communities, so I can also reach out to them. And again, the Cabo Verdean community in both Brockton, Dorchester, Fall River, New Bedford. We're a nice, tight-knit community, so wherever there are Cape Verdeans, and if I can do anything for them, I'm definitely trying to be around those areas as well. So whatever outreach I can do, whether it's, again, going to the schools with you, meeting with the local politicians in town, or doing whatever we have to do to get inside those communities and get in front of them and deliver our message, I think.
So currently, do you feel like there's a lot of attorneys that are represented by the Cape Verdean community?
Absolutely not. At all. I don't feel like we're adequately represented in terms of being in the legal field. And of course, having folks that can speak the language, of course, I can speak Cape Verdean. Again, I was born in America, so it's a slightly different, but again, it's clear that again, I can connect with them. Of course, when you're able to speak the language, it kind of provides a different level of comfort, you know what I mean? So, but again, there are certainly a few Cape Verdean attorneys that I've heard of, but I wish we were there were more of us.
Okay. So now, if there was let's look for a 15-year-old Cape Verdean kid in high school right now who is trying to figure out where he's gonna go in life. Mm. What would you say to him if he wanted to join the legal field?
That's a great question. The first thing I would let him know is that. He would be able to do anything that he puts his mind to. So if that's really something that he was interested in, I feel like it would kind of be the Legal Outlier's job to make sure that we can give him the tools that are tools necessary so that he can get started or have the opportunity to pursue what he wants to do in the legal field. So it's all about the opportunity, I would say. As long as we can provide that opportunity for them and clarity on exactly what they're getting into, I think that's a great start for them.
Okay, so now when you say, so let's speak from a law student in your third year, what challenges do you feel that you face, and what challenges do you feel people from that community will face? Rather it's the language barrier, rather it's the understanding of laws, or what do you think the biggest challenge would be? So first tell us your challenge, and then tell us the challenge you think the community will face.
That's another great question. So the biggest challenge I had with law school, you're referring to? With law school. I think the biggest challenge was realizing it's not like anything you've done before. Like, you kind of know that, hey, this is this cool thing. I've been through high school. I've been through college. You know what I mean? I did what I had to do to get through it. But then if you have that same mentality going into law school, it essentially smacks you in the face and wakes you up a little bit. Like, the last-minute cram, and it really doesn't work. You kind of really have to be organized if you want to succeed. And I feel like you should want to put in that time if you do want to be a lawyer, because, again, this is what we're going to be doing as our profession, so you shouldn't cut any corners anywhere. So the biggest thing was, again, just taking it as seriously as I am currently at the moment and realizing how much time I was going to have to dedicate to it. The hardest issue for a younger Cape Verdean to get into law school, or just to even be eligible for, or not eligible, but just to attend it. I would say first and foremost, if there's any kind of language barrier, that's definitely going to be an issue. They would certainly have to get the adequate, some kind of training in terms of the language, because again, understanding these laws, speaking English is difficult enough, you know what I mean? So if I had to interpret, again, a different language, and I myself wasn't comfortable with the language, it would be very, very difficult. So I would say the language barrier would be the main thing, again, assuming they came from Cape Verde. But if they were raised here, then it's just access and letting them know that they could do it. You know what I mean? Everybody, well, not everybody, let me speak for myself. When I was younger, I kind of put an attorney on a pedestal and thought that, hey, that's kind of not attainable for what I'm trying to do. For me, I don't think I could do it. But then as I was just going through it, and again, just as life developed, I finally realized that whatever I want to do and put my mind to, I can get it done. So again, I decided to go to school, and knock on wood, school's been going well so far. Hopefully we'll be sitting for the bar next July. So time to get it done. Oh, the most important piece of advice actually would be to remember, or if they're not, if they don't know, to be aware that Massachusetts is a state for bar admittance to be admitted to the bar, that they take into account the totality of the circumstances, given if you have a troubled past. So the one thing I would like to let all the viewers know is that regardless of what happened in your past, that doesn't necessarily mean that it will impact your future. So please don't have that be as a deterrent or any reason not to pursue your dream of joining the legal profession. Because again, I'm sure there are many lawyers with a troubled past that that were admitted to the bar. That again, they showed that they made the necessary changes in their lives that was needed to become again a member of the legal profession. So always be aware that again, mistakes. Everybody makes mistakes. Things happen to everybody. But don't let that deter you. Don't let your past necessarily influence your future. So just because something happened in the past, everything is assuming you you just put your head down and know what you have to do. Everything will be okay in the future.
All right, well, thanks, Manny.
Again, man.
It's my guy. Appreciate
anytime,
it. You
anytime,
know?
Brother. You know that. Anything we need to
hey,
do.
Hey, listen.
For,
stay tuned.
Please.
Great guy here.
Just
subscribe. Subscribe. Subscribe.
Just a rubber band on my wrist. No jewels. I ain't got to prove I'm rich. I'm no fool. I know the rules and I ain't got time for it.
I'm a hustler, I'm a hustler, homie. I'm a hustler, I'm a hustler.